Good morning everyone. So let us start the today's session. I hope you all have given your exams very well. So today we will be learning about few programs which is related to the chapter nested loop only. So today I'm going to tell you about a program in which we are going to check that the number is palindrome or not. So first of all, let us see that what is palindrome number. You can see on the screen that I have written few numbers here, 1, 2, 1, 333, and then 262. So these are the numbers which are called as palindrome. Palindrome numbers are actually those numbers which are written same from left to right and right to left. So if I write here 1, 2, 1, so you can see if you read it from left to right and right to left, it will be same. So how we can find out that a particular number which is entered by the user is palindrome or not? So for that, we have to take a number from the user. We have to take an input. So let us begin with writing an input line. So I'm taking a variable num here where I will store the number which is entered by the user. So I am defining here in data type to take the input, enter any number. So here the number which is entered by the user will be saved. Now, what is the logic behind finding out the palindrome number? That we have to save the reverse of this number. As suppose user has entered 1, 2, 1 here. So after entering 1, 2, 1, we need to get it stored somewhere in a reverse form. And then we will check it with the original number that it is palindrome or not. So how we can check it? For getting it in the reverse form, we are going to divide the number. Suppose the number is 1, 2, 1. So I will divide it by 10. As we know that the mod operator gives us the remainder. So when I will use the mod operator here, you can see it will give me the output as 1, right? So I will take a variable and then I will store this 1 there. After that, I will divide this 1, 2 again with 10. So what I will get? I will get the remainder as 2. So I will add these two numbers in a variable, and then when you will divide this remaining number 1 by 10, 1 mod 10, so it is going to give you the remainder as 1. So this is how I will save it in a reverse form, and then I will check it with the original one. So let's start how we are going to save it. So for that, if you want to get the number checked, as you can see that the number of, you can say the task which is appearing here, it is checking the numbers thrice. Right, so it means we have to write a looping statement here where the loop executes till the time the remainder becomes 0. So if the number is greater than 0, till the time number will be greater than 0, we will execute the loop and then we will do all these calculation inside the looping statement. So I'm using a while loop statement here. I have written while number is greater than 0. So till the time the number will be greater than 0, this loop will execute. First time I am taking a variable name digit, digit, where I am going to divide, use a mod operator, and I am going to divide it by 10. So it will give me the remainder. First of all, the last digit will be stored here, which is 1. So 1 will be stored in digit. Now what is the concept? That we have to store this digit somewhere else, right? And before that, I need that when the second time loop executes, it gives me the output as 12, so that we can again divide it by 10. So what I am going to do here, I will write here num is equal to num divided by 10. Then now, why I have used the floor division operator here? Because this is also called an integer division operator. If I will use the divide sign, then it will store the a fractional part also. And we don't need a fractional part here because I want to reverse a number. So I am using a floor division operator here. Right. So how it executes, let's see. First of all, when you will enter the number here, the number will be stored. Let's say I have entered 1, 2, 1. Now 1 to 1 is greater than 0. Yes, condition is true here. 1 to 1 is greater than 0. So the control will go to this line. Digit is equal to num mod 10. So when you will do num mod 10, what it is going to give you the output? It will give you the output 1. The last digit of this number will be stored here. Now, num equals to num floor division 10. It will give you the output as 1 to 1 floor division 10. So, what it is going to give you the answer? Let's say floor division 10. It will give me the answer as 1 to. So, in between where I have get this 1, 2, when this loop will execute again. So, here 1, 2 will be divided by 10. But before that, I want to store this 1 which I have got. So, here I am going to write one more line that I am taking a reverse variable here, which I am defining here as 0. Reverse is equal to 0. Now, what I am going to do, I am going to use a logic here that reverse is equal to reverse into 10. Plus digit. So for the first time when you will do here, like reverse is 0, so 0 into 10 is 0 again, 0 into 10, 0 into 10 plus 1. So what output will get? 1 here, we will get 1. Now, when the second time loop will execute, as this loop will not get false because now it will check for 1, 2 is greater than 0. So, it will, the condition will become true again. 1, 2 will be divided by mod, the mod operator will be used. So, 1, 2, we will do it 1, 2 mod 10. So, the output will be 2 here. Now, what will be the output of the reverse? As now, reverse is equal to reverse into 10 plus digit is written. So earlier in reverse we got stored the value 1 into 10 plus digit which is 2. So what output we are going to get? 12, right? Now here we will get 1 mod 10, 1 integer division 10. So this answer is 1 here. Now this loop will again not get false because right now again the condition is true, 1 is greater than 0. So now 1 mod 10 will be equals to 10 is 1. Now reverse is equal to reverse into 10 plus digit. So reverse was 12 into 10 plus 1. So it will be 121. Now here we don't have anything here. So it means The condition is fulfilled. Now it will come out of the loop. So we are going to print here reverse number. So you can see that reverse is stored. Now the concept is that once the reverse is stored here and we got it printed, we need to now check this reverse number with this original number that these are same or not. So if both of these will be same, then it will be said that it is a palindrome. So I am writing here if condition, if reverse number is must equal to num, number entered by the user, then print palindrome, else print not palindrome. All right, so let us see how it get executed. So let us see how it works. Palindrome saved now. So I am entering here 121. So you can see that it is showing us not palindrome. Why it is showing not palindrome? So now let's see that what is the error here. Why it is showing only the else part? It is because that the number which is stored in the reverse, it was 121. The number which was entered in num, it was 1 to 1, but further we have done the calculation here, so it is storing the last value of the num. That is why it is showing not palindrome. So what we are going to do here is that we are going to store this original value in some another variable. For example, let's write here num1 is equal to num. So it means the calculation will be done on the num part and we are going to check this original value with the original value num1 with the reverse value which we have stored here. Let's execute the program. So you can see that we got the output palindrome. Let us check it with not palindrome number as well, because our program should be accurate with both the statements. Alright, so you can see that 4 to 1 is the reverse number and it is not a palindrome number. And when we entered 1 to 1, it shows that it is a palindrome number. So this is how you can find out the reverse of a number and check it with the original one and see that whether it is a palindrome or not. I hope you have understood this, student. Now, I got two more questions from you that how to find out the average from the list of the numbers. So let us do that program now. To find out the average from the list of numbers, I'm going to define here the list. And suppose I write few numbers here, for example 12, 31, any number you can write. Alright, so I have defined a list in a square bracket with the name LST. Now, to find out the average, what is the best part or what you can apply the logic is that you find out the length of this list, and what we are going to do, we will execute the loop, and the loop in the loop, it will read the particular value from a particular position, and we are going to add all those value in one variable, and then we are going to find out the average. So let us find out the length first of all. Now length is equal to, we have already learned about the len function, which is going to find out the length of the list. So here the length of the list is 5, right? Now we are going to execute the loop here for I in range. And the length will start from 0 till length. Okay. So, it will go till 0 to 4. So, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Right. Because this upper limit is excluded. Now, okay. So, what we are going to do first, when we find out the length of the list, now I am going to execute a loop which will read this value of the list from its I position. And then I'm going to add all those value from its I position. So I have taken here the variable name as sum, and I'm adding the value of sum to the ith position of the list. So to add the value, I have to define here sum as well, because first time the sum will store the value as 0. So when the sum is 0, so first time when the loop will execute, it will read the value from the 0th position of the list, which is 12. And 12 will be added to the sum. So 0 plus 12 is equal to 12. Second time this ith position will be added here. And this is how it will be completed. When the loop will get false, if the control will go out of the loop, we are going to find out the average. So till the time we'll get the sum of all the numbers. So I'm writing here average. Let's take a variable avg is equal to sum by, what is the formula to find out the average? Total of the numbers. So the total we have already got here in the length variable. So this is the our average of list is equal to, and then value will get from average. Now here you can see that the list is taken. List is stored in the LST variable. Length I have find out with the length variable. So length is 5. Now sum is 0. When the loop control will come here for I in range 0, 5. So the first position of the list is stored here right now. So I have added it to the sum variable. 0 plus list I position. So 12 will be added here. First time the value of the sum will be 12. When the second time the loop will go, so it will run from 1, 5. So the list, first position of the list will be read by the control, and then it will be added to the variable sum. So as the value of the sum was 12, so 12 plus 32 will be done, and then 14 will be added, and then 11 will be added, and then 23. So this is how we'll get the sum of all the numbers from the list. And when the control will go out of the list, when the loop will become false, we will find out the average with the sum divided by length. So length is 5, we have already calculated here. So after that I have written the printing line in which I am printing the average of the number. Let's run the program and see that if is it giving us the output which we have thought of. So average of the list is 18. If you find out here by adding, you will get the answer as 18. So this is how you can find out the average from the list of the numbers entered by the user. I hope you have understood both of these programs, the average of the number and the palindrome, finding out the palindrome of the particular number. So practice both these programs at home. If there will be any problem, then you can ask me. I'll show you more programs with the nested loop in the upcoming videos. Till then, stay safe, stay home. Thank you so much.